If you ever plan to motor west, travel my way, take the highway, that's the best. I get your kicks on Route 66.
It began in 1967. Ticket prices were $12. And there were 32,000 empty seats. Just over half the seats were filled when the teams took the field. Of course, they didn't even secure the location of the game until 6 weeks before the game. True. The TV audience was pathetic, even though it was broadcast on two networks. Both NBC and CBS carried it. Twice as many people tuned in to watch a rerun that night of the Beverly Hillbillies. It was called the Championship Game back then, which didn't really carry a big pop. That wasn't like a big zing name, the Championship Game. And the first two games between the powerful NFL, which had been in existence for 50 years, that was the long-term league, and the upstart AFL, which had only been around 7 years, they weren't exactly barn burner games, those first two games. The mighty Green Bay Packers of the NFL pummeled the Kansas City Chiefs 35-10. And then the following year, the Green Bay Packers again took the Oakland Raiders to the woodshed, 33-14. It was the third year of this game that made all the difference. It was that year that they changed the name to the Super Bowl. And that's the official bulletin of the third Super Bowl. And boy, did this game live up to its name. The teams couldn't have been more opposite, if you remember it, if you're that old. The heavily favored Baltimore Colts, they came in supremely confident, a great team. And they were confident even though they didn't have their first-string quarterback for the game. In fact, he was a Hall of Fame quarterback, and they didn't have him. Johnny Unitas was his name, and he was injured earlier that year. But their team was so good that his backup, a guy named Earl Morrill, came in, and what did he do? Well, he won the NFL MVP award that year as a backup, and he came in to take his place. But it was the underdog New York Jets that stole all the headlines. Being in the media capital of the world didn't hurt, but their young, brash, trend-setting quarterback, Joe Namath, he proved to be a media magnet, that guy. They gave him the nickname Broadway Joe because he loved the lights. He loved the nightlife. He loved the attention. He was seen in all the swankiest places. There he is right there. He dated the prettiest girls. He hung out with the most famous people of the day, Barbara Streisand and Raquel Welch and Mickey Mantle, Anne Margaret, Farrah Fawcett. He brought a cool factor to the game that it hadn't been there before. How many times you see an athlete wearing that on the sidelines? But Joe did, and he seduced the media at all times. The Colts, they couldn't compete with that. Their quarterbacks wore black high tops and sported crew cuts, both of them. They weren't exactly hipster material even for that day. They were kind of the old guard. But it was something that Broadway Joe did before the game that got the greatest attention. It was something that athletes up until that time never did. Joe guaranteed victory. He guaranteed his team would win. Now, the guarantee was news itself, but it was really news because the Jets were prohibitive underdogs. And that made the prediction even more newsworthy. The Colts were favored to win, get this, by 3 touchdowns. Huge margin. They had ended their season winning their last 10 games. They had shut out 4 of those teams. To get to the Super Bowl, in the NFL side, their championship game, they played the Cleveland Browns, and they beat the Cleveland Browns 34-0. That was in the championship game to get to the Super Bowl. And yet, all we remember from Super Bowl III is the iconic video. Here's a picture of it. Joe Namath got the number one sign up there, waving his finger, symbolizing who was the best team in the world that year. Joe guaranteed it and became a living legend, a superhero. We're in a series called Route 66, and we're traveling through the 66th book of the Bible, and we're stopping at some key places of interest along the way. And today's stop is Guarantee Garage. It's a great place to be. Many bold guarantees are parked in Guarantee Garage. Much more bold than any athlete has ever predicted, I guarantee it. You know, it's amazing to me how many athletes today guarantee victories. They do. You see it all the time. They're guaranteeing victories. Joe was kind of the first, but they're really empty guarantees when you think about it. And even Joe's, that was an empty guarantee if you think about it. They don't back it up with anything, do they? They don't say, have you ever heard an athlete say, I'm going to guarantee this year's salary. I will give this year's $20 million salary to charity if we don't win this game. Have you ever seen? I've never heard an athlete say that. Never, not once. They don't back it up with anything. And if they lose, it's like yesterday's news. You don't even hear about it, that they guaranteed it. If they win, the athlete's like strutting around like he did something. He took a risk in guaranteeing victory. Whoopee-doo. The guarantees we're going to discuss today aren't empty words. Far from it. The person who made them put his life on the line. You see, Jesus Christ made many guarantees, many promises, many claims. And that's the area of our Route 66 guide that we're stopping at. And if you don't have this guide, raise your hand. We got ushers that'll come get you one, but this is a New Testament one. And what we do is we go to the central areas on the back, and each Sunday we kind of take one of them. And last week we did Jesus' ministry. This week we're going to do Jesus' claims. Jesus' claims. And Jesus had a particular way of making his claims. He had a particular way to make his guarantees. There are a couple phrases that he used to just set them up. Now, that doesn't mean that that's the only time Jesus ever made promises. Every word out of his mouth was a promise. He never said anything that wasn't the absolute truth. In fact, he reminded me of a show that I loved. It was back in the 1990s. Back in the 1990s, there was an actor named Marlon Brando. Anybody remember Marlon Brando? Marlon Brando in the 70s did this big show called The Godfather. Won an Academy Award for it, stuff like that. You might not have known of a little movie he did in the 1990s where he spoofed himself. It was called The Freshman. It was one of the funnier movies I'd seen that year. I just still remember it, where Marlon Brando played this Godfather-type character, but it was a comedy, and he was spoofing himself. And I loved how the movie went along, but he played this Godfather character, and an actor named Matthew Broderick was kind of his foil. And I remember one scene specifically. When Matthew Broderick came and Marlon Brando was doing his old, I can't do his voice, but he was doing the huge Godfather thing. You know, and he was telling him something. And Matthew Broderick says, you promise? And I love the line that Marlon Brando said after that. He goes, every word out of my mouth, by definition, is a promise. Is that a great line or what? And guess what? Jesus is neither the Godfather nor a gangster, but he has that similar with Marlon Brando. every word out of Jesus' mouth is by definition a promise. Jesus only told what can come true. But there were certain things that Jesus emphasized, certain things that he wanted to accentuate. And there were two main ways he did that. The first is, he'd be in a room of people, or he'd be outside on a hilltop or in a field, and he'd stop and he'd look at everyone and he'd say, "I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth." Now, some of your Bibles, if you read them, depending on what translation you have, may say things like, "Verily, verily, I say unto you." That would be the King James Version. Maybe you have that version. And Jesus sitting on the mountaintop going, "Verily, verily, I say unto you." Maybe you have this one where he says, "Assuredly, I say to you." That would be the New King James Version. Or maybe you have one where he says, "Truly, I tell you." That would be the New International Version. Or some of you might have this where he says, "I promise you." That would be the Contemporary English Version. Maybe others, you have this one, "I ain't lying." That would be the New York Version. Just kidding, I made that one up myself. But they all essentially mean the same thing. "I tell you the truth," which is from the New Living Translation. And if you're a person confused about why some organizations like Gideon or some churches, name a bunch, that say the only Bible we can use is the King James Version. If you're confused about that, join the club, because so am I. I have no idea. No, it's not a biblical decision they made. It might be a religious decision they made, which is why I'm so glad we're non-denominational. Because here at Compass, we don't worry about the religious decisions. We care about only care about the biblical decisions. And nowhere in the Bible does it say, you know what, King James translation is the only good translation. In fact, there's many good translations. Never says use the King James only. Most mainstream English translations, New Living, ESV, which is English Standard Translation, NIV, NASB, New American Standard, New King James Version is not. They're all good. And they're all translated not from the King James Version. They don't translate from that. The word translation, by definition, is I went back to the original Hebrew, the original Aramaic, and the original Greek. Those are the three languages the Bible is originally written in. And each of these translations go, and they translate from that original text. And I always tell people this. Go to one of those mainstreams and use the one that you connect with the best. That's the one you should use, the one you connect with the best. Because unless you speak Old English, the King James Version might not be the one for you. It might be a little hard to read. And let me tell you something. Jesus never wanted his words to be hard to read. They might be hard to hear because he's saying some things that you might not like to hear. That's true. But they never should be hard to read. Jesus, when he taught, he actually spoke the common language of the day. He didn't speak the highfalutin language of the day. He didn't say words that only the privileged few or the educated elite would even understand. He told stories. He used common analogies and metaphor, like fishing, like shepherding, like eating, all the time, which is why the common everyday people loved Jesus. It's why they followed Jesus. He spoke to them. He was their rabbi. And when he said, "I tell you the truth," they leaned in because they knew the next words out of his mouth was going to be something special. And they didn't want to miss a single word. And it was then that he would say things that people had never heard before, things that went against conventional wisdom, bold, audacious proclamations about life, about people, about the future. And the people said, "This man teaches with authority." And every time Jesus said, "I tell you the truth," it seemed like that authority to them, it came straight from God. So they didn't want to miss a word. Because he would talk about this kingdom that God had. And he would say things like this in John 3. He started with, and say this with me, I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth. And he leaned in and he said, unless you're born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And people would wonder, well, how could you be born twice? And Jesus would talk about a spiritual birth, to give your life to God, that God's going to do some house cleaning, and you'll be a new creation. And then Jesus said something that completely wowed everybody. He said, that kingdom, it's open to all of you. It's open to everybody. It's open to anyone. And that God loves it when his children who had wandered away come back. He loves it. Even if out of 100 people, just one left and came back. Jesus said, boy, God celebrates that. Celebrates that. Matthew 18 says this. Say this with me. I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth. He will rejoice over that more than the 99 that didn't wander away. It is not my heavenly Father's will that even one should perish. And people started to get excited. Because up until the time of Jesus, the religious leaders in Israel made people follow these rules and these rituals. And even then, it wasn't even certain that they'd ever get into heaven. They just needed to follow them. And Jesus never talked about rules. And he never talked about some level of goodness that you had to reach before you can get into heaven, before you can get into the kingdom of God, before you can taste the kingdom of God. One time he even got a little frustrated with the utter arrogance of the priests, the air of condescension that they had toward their own people. And he looked at the priest, and in Matthew chapter 21, verse 31, Jesus said this, say it with me, I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth. And people leaned in and he said, corrupt tax collectors and prostitutes will get into the kingdom before you do. And he pointed at the religious leaders. And the religious leaders were stunned. And all the people were kind of giggling under their breath. Oh my gosh. But it was a turning point in the history of Israel. Here's this rabbi, Jesus, speaking with an authority that no one had ever seen, no one had ever heard before. And heaven was becoming real and exciting. And God was becoming real and approachable. It was something different. And it was like everyone was a kid again, with hope and wonder and enthusiasm. And that was good. Because Jesus said this in Mark 10. Say it with me. He said, I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth. He said, anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. And he went on to explain all the attributes of a child that he was talking about. Dependence, humility, honesty, curiosity, trust, excitement, empathy, resilience, faith. Faith, the faith of a child. And then he made it another outrageous claim. He said, you know what? All it takes is the faith of a child, and you can do wonders. He said this in Matthew 17. Say it with me. I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth. If you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. What? This was new for the people. You see, they always looked up to these rabbis that told them, well, you got to do this, you got to do this, and you got to give this, and you got to do this on this day, and this on this day, and act like this, and say this. This was a whole new rabbi, this Jesus. And he made claims that were just amazing. And Jesus was pointing to the things inside of us that made us strong. Not the things we do, not the things we pretend to do in front of others, like some of the religious leaders did. It was the things inside of us that Jesus concentrated on. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 2, said this, when you give to someone in need, this is Jesus talking, don't do as the hypocrites do, blowing trumpets in the synagogue and streets to call attention to their acts of charity. Say this with me, I tell you the truth. they have received their reward in full. He said, you don't have to be all about the show. It's not all about the show. You don't have to be all about how you try to impress others. He said that God knows when you're kind. God knows when you're generous. God knows when you're compassionate. And he will reward you. So you got a choice. You could wait for God's reward, knowing the resources that are available to God, or you can make a big production now about what you do and settle for fleeting recognition of your adoring public. You got a choice. In other words, Jesus said self-promotion isn't high on the list of attributes that God admires. Muhammad Ali was one of the greatest fighters, greatest boxers ever. But he was the poster child for self-promotion. He would take any opportunity to say, I'm the greatest. I'm Superman. I'm the greatest. I'm Ali. That was Ali. Well, one time he was flying a commercial airline, and the flight attendant came over to him and said, Mr. Ali, would you buckle your seatbelt? And he looked at her and started talking in his usual bombastic way. He goes, I'm Superman. I'm Superman. Superman don't need no seatbelt. And without missing a beat, the flight attendant looked at him and said, Superman don't need no plane neither. So buckle up. But the claims that Jesus made, he even could predict the future with precise accuracy. And on the night before he was crucified, he shared a supper with his closest disciples. And he made this revelation in John 13, verse 21. Say it with me. I tell you the truth. You get the feeling that Jesus said that a lot. He wanted people to know, I tell you the truth. I'm not lying to you. I tell you the truth. He said, I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me. And it happened. Judas, one of his disciples, betrayed Jesus that very night. But before the rest of the disciples can get all, hey, well, at least it's not me, they're all leaving the room. And one of his other disciples, Peter, came over to him kind of as an encouragement to Jesus. He just wanted to encourage and assure Jesus. And Peter says, I'll die for you, Lord. I'll die for you. And Jesus, loving Peter, but knowing his misplaced exuberance, said this to Peter in John 13, 38. Say it with me. I tell you the truth. Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. And you can kind of see Jesus smile and his hand on Peter's shoulder. I love you. I'm glad you're willing to die for me, but you're going to deny me three times before the rooster crows. Peter's like, no, no. But it happened. Everything Jesus said happened. So what to make of all this? I mean, these claims of Jesus, they were astonishing. They were outrageous. They were shocking. And here's the thing. It wasn't like Jesus had some sort of constant glow like you see in certain pictures. You know, you've seen these pictures like this. And there's a ton of these. I could have shown you a bunch of them. And we paint him today with this constant glow. Newsflash, Jesus didn't have the constant glow. He looked like any other Galilean. He had a Galilean accent. He had carpenter's hands. He was indistinguishable from any other Galilean man. There was no way you can see him in any different way than any other man. But mere men did not make the claims that he did. That's where he distinguished himself. They didn't make these kind of claims. So people, when they heard Jesus, they started to think a little different of him. He's got this authority, and this authority, it sounds like it comes from God. He must be sent from God. But Jesus, he didn't want to leave it just there. He wanted to clarify that. So he used a phrase he liked to call himself. He liked to call himself the Son of Man. And in John 1:51, he says this. Say this with me. I tell you the truth. you will see heaven open and angels of God descending and ascending on the Son of Man, the bridge between heaven and earth. So Jesus, he claims to be the bridge between heaven and earth. He claims to be the bridge to God. That's amazing. When one man says this, this Galilean man who looked just similar, just like everybody else. This claim is amazing. But Jesus, he went further than that. Sorry, I don't want to stop there. I'm not just the bridge. He said in John 5:24, say it with me. I tell you the truth. Those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but have already passed from death to life. So he's not just the bridge. He's the ticket to get across the bridge. That's amazing. And it's claims like these that piqued people's curiosity. But Jesus didn't stop there. He wanted there to be absolutely no doubt who he was. So he upped the ante, so to speak. And he started making his claims in the first person. And he began each phrase with, I am. I am. I am. And you hear some of Jesus' I am claims, you'll be stunned at the absolute clarity. Especially since, if you ever listen to people today about Jesus, I love how I get in a conversation, and this happens to me all the time. They know I'm a pastor, so they might say, you know, they might want to try to impress me with their knowledge of something or whatever, and they'll say what Jesus should be or what he is. He's a good man, good teacher, all that. I hear all that kind of stuff. Well, that couldn't be true. Have you ever read the Bible? But today, people say anything. And I just want to say, did you read what he said about himself? Because we just want to make him who we want him to be. There's a website I stumbled across where teachers posted some unusual answers that students gave to their test questions. I love this. It's great. Just a few of them. I want to give you an example. Question. What is a fibula? One of the students said, a little lie. Question, what might living next to a cell phone tower be, why might living next to a cell phone tower be bad for your health? Answer, you might walk into it. These are brilliant students, by the way. I know we have many teachers. Do you have students like this, you teacher out there? It's good. So another question, test question. What was unique about Abraham Lincoln's birth? Answer, he was born in a log cabin which he built with his own hands. That is unique. It's amazing. Question. These are actual now. Cause and effect. Tony practices the violin 20 minutes a day. What's the effect? Answer, Tony is a big nerd. That's possible. Love this one. Question. To change centimeters to meters, you? Answer. Take out the centa. Good answer. Not sure it's the right answer. Love this one. Question. This is a math question. Find X. Answer. Here it is. Amen to that, huh? How many people, math majors like me, would just, that's my answer, baby. Whew. If that was on the SAT, that's exactly what I'd do. Students reaching for excellence and falling a bit short. Would you not agree? And we laugh. But some of the answers that you saw there reflect the same sort of ignorance that we hear today in answers to questions about who Jesus is. It's like people make up whatever they want and forget that there was quite a few historians in the first century. Quite a few. And Jesus made quite a stir. And his words and his actions were noteworthy. And they're recorded not just in the Bible, but his words and his actions were recorded by historians from Rome, outside the Bible. We got them. You can't just make up stuff about Jesus. He caused a stir back then. We know what he did. We know what happened. We know what he said. And we talked about last week how one of the main priorities of Jesus' ministry that was to leave no doubt that he was the Son of God. The Son of God. Not a son of God, the son of God. I mean, we're all adopted sons and daughters of God. I get that. We are. But there's only one true son of God. There's only one person who's ever walked this earth that is truly divine in the God sense of that word. And it's Jesus. And Jesus said this in John 8:58. Say it with me. I tell you the truth. Before Abraham was born, say it, I am. Now, for some of you who've never read that before, that might sound a little grammatically incorrect. Or grammatically, is that what I'm saying? I'm an English major, by the way. Yeah. Whatever that is, that might sound incorrect. But it's not. Jesus was using the name that God called himself when Moses asked, who are you? Who are you, God? He said, I am. I'm not I was. I'm not I will be. I am. I exist now. I existed then. I will exist. I am. Jesus says, before Abraham was born, I am. And everybody knew what that meant. This guy, he's claiming to be God. He's not just a good teacher. He's telling us he's the Messiah. He's telling us he's the one prophesied about for over 1,000 years. He's God coming down from heaven to be the Redeemer, to be the Savior. He's not just a good teacher or a good man. He didn't leave us that option. He claimed to be God. So he's either, as I said last week, a liar, a lunatic, or Lord, the Lord God. You got to make up your mind. Mark 14:61 said this. The high priest asked him, are you the Messiah, the Son of God? Jesus said, I am. I am. And if you look in your New Testament Bible guide, you'll see on one of the sides, 29 key prophecies fulfilled by Jesus. Wrote them down here. That's not all the key prophecies, just enough we had room for, given the size of the font. We couldn't go any lower than that. 29 key prophecies fulfilled by Jesus. And these are messianic prophecies. These are prophecies about this is who the Messiah will be. And depending on what Bible scholar you listen to, there's between 60 and 300 prophecies that are fulfilled by Jesus. But the key is every prophecy, every messianic prophecy, every prophecy period about God, Jesus fulfilled every one. Now you can dicker on how many there are. A lot of people go, okay, this might be a prophecy, this, that, and that's fine. There's between 60 and 300. Doesn't matter. He fulfilled every one. Dr. Peter Stoner, a renowned mathematician. Good name for a mathematician, huh, Stoner? You got to be a stoner to like math, but he published a book where he calculated the probability that any one man could fulfill eight of the messianic prophecies. And he wrote a book on it, mathematician, renowned. And the answer was 1 in 10 to the 17th power. That's 1 with 10 and 17 zeros behind it. That's just that one man could fulfill eight of the messianic prophecies. And to illustrate how unlikely that is, Stoner gave this illustration. It's a great illustration. He said, I want you to cover the entire state of Texas with silver dollars, 2 feet deep. The entire state of Texas, silver dollars, 2 feet deep. Then I want you to go out and I want you to put a mark, an X on one of those, and then randomly stuff it somewhere back in the state. Now I want you to blindfold somebody. And I want you to send them walking over the state of Texas. And they can cover the whole state if they want to. And then at some point in time, they got to pick down and pick one up. The probability of one person fulfilling eight messianic prophecies is the same as a person walking through the state of Texas blindfolded, 2 feet deep of silver dollars and grabbing the one with the mark on it. It's the same probability. Jesus fulfilled every one, not just eight, every one. And he wasn't shy about claiming that. And the truth of that, the divinity of Jesus, puts all his other I am claims into perspective. if this man's indeed God, then all his other I am claims, we might want to listen. Like when he said in John chapter 6, he said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Jesus claimed he's the bread of life. If you've ever hungered for meaning or purpose in your life, if you've ever thirsted for the one place where all your needs can be met, both physically and spiritually, it's Jesus. I am the bread of life. He's the sustainer. But that's not all. It's not all. It doesn't stop there. John 8, 12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus claimed that he was the light of the world. If you've ever felt lost, if you've ever felt confused in your life, if you ever felt like you're going through dark times and you're in those darkness areas, Jesus is your light back to the truth. Boy, today we walk in lies. We do. It's hard to find the truth in the society we live in. Jesus says, I'm the light of the world. I'm your light. Back to the truth about yourself and about life. But he didn't stop there. That's not all. John 10 said, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as my Father knows me, and I know my Father, and I will lay down my life for my sheep. Jesus is the good shepherd. What do shepherds do? They protect the sheep. If you've ever felt vulnerable in your life, if you ever felt beat up on in your life, felt like you can't get ahead, felt like oppressed all the time, Jesus claimed to be your and my good shepherd. He'll protect you. So fear not, and behold, Jesus will lay his life down for you. That should be pretty comforting, amen? He's our good shepherd. This is God. All these others, if he's God, then all these others, this is easy. Easy for Jesus to be the good shepherd. But that's not all. He said in John 15, he said, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Jesus is the vine, the source of life. Everything in value, everything of any value in life, fruit, comes from him. Everything that we do that's valuable in life comes from him. He's the source. He's the vine or the branch. But that's not all. He didn't stop there. John 11, 25. I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. What does that mean? He's the conqueror. He's the victor. He beat death and gives life to us. Amen? These are powerful claims. Don't gloss over them. This is God making these claims. If it's true in one area, and true in here, and true in here, and true 300 other times, he fulfills. This is easy for him. Do you take Jesus at his word? I hope so. He's your resurrection and your life. He's your true vine. He's your bread sustaining you. He's your good shepherd to protect you. But he doesn't stop there. John 14, 6, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. He's the way, the truth, the life, not just a way, not just a truth. You have your truth, I have my truth. I love that statement. Really? Thank God Jesus never said that. The way, the truth, the life. He's the only way to God. the only way to heaven. He's the only truth. All truth is found in Jesus, period. There can't be truth apart from Jesus. That's a powerful statement, and that's what Jesus makes. That's the claim Jesus makes. Nowhere else can you find truth but in Jesus. And nowhere else can you find life, life eternal, but in Jesus. But let's be honest. Most of us read this stuff, and we've heard it so many times, it doesn't even make a dent in our daily existence. I got to tell you, that's sad. It's sad when I let that happen. It's sad when you let that happen. Because the claims of Jesus, when we know them to be true, could change everything. And I mean everything about your daily life. Not just your life here on Sundays, but your daily life. It'll change how confident you are. I got the Lord as my shepherd. I got God watching over me. Change the hope that you have. I know the way. I've got total hope. I know the way. I know the truth. I know the life. I know the bridge. The peace that you rest in. Man, everything's taken care of. He's the bread. I'll never hunger, never thirst. The love that you show, everything good comes from God. Everything good comes from Christ. If I want to truly love somebody, I got to be connected to Jesus. He's the source. He's the vine. Amen? On your daily, everyday life, going to Jesus. You got to admit, there's a lot of claims out there. There's a lot of promises out there. There's a lot of guarantees out there that have been made over the years by people, by athletes, by salesmen, by products, by companies. Only one was willing to die for his claims. Only one. Nobody else. And he did. Maybe that's because he claimed to be God. Turns out, he was. Turns out, he proved it. He died for the claims that he made and then rose again 3 days later to prove his claims were always true. Amen? My hope is that you'll take a closer look at those claims on a daily basis and be confident and secure that Jesus' claims for your life personally are true. Amen? Let's pray.